Village. For those of you that don't know me, I've been researching the past 100 years for a while, and I wrote an article that's right here about the centennial. So we're going to talk about some of the things that happened in the past 100 years. And we have to go back a little bit earlier than 100 years ago to be able to tell this story. We're going to go back to Jacob Henrici's final year in 1892. John Duff became a trustee. The first year that he was a trustee, he was just kind of laying a little low and not really discussing too much, just trying to figure out what he had to do. But then the year after that was 1892. He started to ask how the society's finances were. And Jacob Henrici had never kept any kind of financial records of anything that the Harmony Society owned. He had receipts in his hat, he had receipts in that bookcase, he had receipts over there in that drawer. It was just kind of wherever. And so John Duss made him do a first and last accounting in the summer of 1892. And he died Christmas Day, 1892. Supposedly, according to John Duss, Henrici was not in a right mind for the last half year of his life. I don't know if that's true or not. But anyways, that's according to Duss. And so he was able to get sole ability to change different things about the society right before Henrici died. About 3 days before he died, he was able to sign things away. When Henrici died Christmas Day, that next year, John Duss started to sell off a lot of what the Harmony Society had. He found during that accounting that the Harmony Society was in debt. They didn't have any money to pay off any kind of debt. So they had to take a mortgage out for, I think it was $110,000. So he said, we need to sell some of this property. And this is one picture of John Duss making a land deal with the Berlin Iron Bridge Company, which is what started the American Bridge Company. And that's why we have the town of Ambridge. It's named after the American Bridge Company. So this is in 1900, and you can see he's standing by a harmonist building and then making the deal. These are the five remaining harmonists. And May 5th, 1903, John Duss, he gave up his membership May 12th, 1903. For leaving, he received $500,000. That was his part of the society. And so he used that to pursue a music career. He introduced water in the Madison Square Garden. And this is a production of Venice. So that was a pretty big undertaking. So anyways, we go back to 1903. There's another harmonist that died that day. April 15th, 1904, I'm sorry. And then December 6th, 1905, Barbara Besch dies, and just two people remaining. And so then 1 week later, the Harmony Society dissolves. December 13th, 1905. And the Dusses moved down to Florida. Susie Duss had glaucoma, and the doctor told her that it was better for her to live somewhere warm. So they moved to Florida, and this is in New Smyrna Beach, Florida. And that's the Duss home. You can see John and Susie up there. John Duss came back in the summers to take care of economy. So nothing really was going on from 1905 to 1910. And then 1910 is when two different people started thinking, you know, this isn't right. Something's not right here. And so they reported to the Auditor General that there's something going on here, and they need to check into it. There was an organization called the Harmony Society Historical Association that was founded to also take care of economy. And this is Fred Knedler. He was a caretaker. That was Christiana Knedler's father. He was a caretaker of the site here until he died in 1936. And he was also one of the board members of the Harmony Society Historical Association. That group kept going until about 1947. And that's when talks of the Harmony Associates started. So in June 1921, they had the first opening day for Old Economy. This is what it looked like then. In 1924, there was a centennial of the founding of Economy. And this is a picture from that. Everyone's wearing harmonist clothes and riding in the parade on a hay wagon. And there was old-timers reunions. The old-timers were anyone that was associated with the Harmony Society in any way. They could have been workers or friends, whatever. And these are some old-timers. And that started in 1936. Well, all this time, time's going on, John Duss is starting to turn his musical interest to religious music. So starting in 1929, he started to write religious music, and this is the Mass of St. Veronica that was performed at St. Veronica's Catholic Church in Ambridge. And there was other things that he wrote in the 1930s. It's interesting to see the difference in his ideas. This is what one of the first exhibits looked like in what they called the Great House, and we call it the George Rapp House. These are artifacts from the Harmony Society, all in the trustees' room or the parlor of the George Rapp House. And over on the table, you might have seen there's a lot of pictures. Those are pictures taken during the Works Progress Administration Museum Extension Project during the 1930s. They were here from 1939 until 1941, and they were here to organize and catalog the collections. So this is one picture of people organizing the archives. You can see what state they were all in at that time. And then Charles Morris Stotts was the architect for the restoration of Old Economy Village. He restored a lot of different places, but Old Economy was always a great love of his. And he came here in 1936 and wrote a book about the early architecture of Western Pennsylvania. And Old Economy Village is really featured prominently in this book. There's a whole chapter on the Harmony Society architecture. So Charles Stotts was here from 1937 as the architect in charge until 1965. So it was a very long restoration. And this is one of the big things that was done during the restoration. The Rapp houses had an extension that was added on sometime in the late 19th century, and this was used for a laundry room. And you can see them demolishing that part, and it doesn't exist now. In the gardens, this is what they looked like during the restoration. Pretty sad compared to today. But the gardens were restored also. That was by Ralph Griswold. And then Karl Arndt also is a prominent figure in Harmony Society history. He discovered the Harmony Society in 1940 in Louisiana, and that's when he discovered a whole bunch of archival documents that were from Count de Leon's group, who went to Louisiana, and he started reading about the Harmony Society and started wondering what that was, and he found Old Economy and came here to research. So he researched all the way until his death. That was a huge part of his life, was to research the Harmony Society, and I think there's 10 books written about the Harmony Society by him, and they're all around 2 to 3 inches thick, each one of them. There's 8 documentary histories and 2 chronological histories. And the first curator and basically director of Old Economy was Dr. Lawrence S. Thurman, and he was here from 1949 until 1965, and he did a lot of organization of artifacts and cataloging, trying to set up exhibits. You can see him working on a mannequin here. In 1951, this is a picture of John Duss and his housekeeper, Mary Fruth. Mary was a cousin of Susie Duss's, John Duss's wife. And this is one of their birthdays in the steward's wing of the George Rapp House. So he died in 1951 in Swickley Hospital. And he's buried in the Harmony Society Cemetery down the street by the library. Susie died in 1946, and her ashes were also buried in John Duss's coffin. Mary, by the way, lived until 1961. She had to move out of the Great House when restoration was happening, and she moved in with her niece, I think, and baby. This is 1956, when the Harmony Associates was developed. And they were established to be a helpful arm of Old Economy, trying to be the people who would hold the funds and try to put on programs for the village. And their first big project was to raise money for the restoration of Old Economy. And they did this by putting on this play called Man's Reach by Gladys Ashley Hoover. And that was put on between 1956 and 1961. And it was a very popular play. So in 1965, after Dr. Thurman left, then Dan Reibel came, and he was here from 1965 until 1981, and he did a lot of work on the cataloging and setting up exhibits. This is probably what he found in this room, just full of all sorts of artifacts. They use this building as a big place for organization and storage. So that's a whole bunch of Carmenist furniture. And then this is how the George Rapp bedroom looked when Dan Rabel set it up. And then in 1972, National Geographic featured Old Economy Village in their education flyer. And this is the live-in program that happened here. And that was a program where children could stay the night and they could learn how to do historic crafts and live like Carmenists, basically. So that was a popular program. In 1973, this is the Teenage Docent Program, which some of you were members of that program here. And they did a lot of things to help put on programs here. They did a lot of hands-on activities, crafts, and things like that. This is a junior high festival in 1973. The Decorative Arts Center was in the second floor of the Frederick Rapp House, and it opened in 1974. And it lasted there until sometime in the 1980s. I'm not sure exactly when that was. But what it was is it was a place to learn about decorative arts. And there was a Germanic room, a Federalist room, a Harmonist room. But Ann Genter was the leader of that project. And then Richard Wetzel was music director and archivist here from 1967 until 1970. And he organized the music archives, which is a very large archive for music like this. And as I understand, it's a very unique archive for early 19th century music. Anyway, he wrote a book about harmonist music. And music was a very, very important program here. There was, in 1974, a program put on in this room again called Lob Gesang. And this was put together through a grant, and this they made harmonist music recordings from this program. And along came Ray Shepherd. A lot of you know Ray Shepherd, and he was the site administrator or director from 1982 until 1997, and then he became the site historian, and he retired in 2004. One of Ray's big projects was the Natural History Museum. In 2002, that is when that opened. That's downstairs here, if you haven't seen it. But anyways, the Harmony Society had a museum here, and so it was his work to reproduce that as best we could from what we have in the archive. And Marianne Landis became the site administrator in 1997. She came here as the curator and then became site administrator in 1997, and she retired in 2009. And music was still a big thing for her, too. And Chuck Krepley came here, I think it was 1998 or 9, and he started a music program again because it had pretty much died away, except for solo music. And so he started it back up and became the orchestra director here. And that lasted for quite a while. Emily Lapisardi was also very important in creating the music aspect here, and she was the choir director, and she interpreted Gertrude Rapp and researched silk history. And then in 2003, we got the visitor center. It was a long time coming. Dan Rabel tried to get a visitor center and was never able to get a visitor center. And one of Mary Ann's big projects was the Kinder House, and that was put in 1398 Church Street, which was a visitor center for a little while here. And now the Kinder House is there, and it's all three-quarter scale furniture and able to be used by children. In the Friends of Old Economy Village, the Harmony Associates changed their name basically to the Friends of Old Economy Village. They're doing business as Friends of Old Economy Village, and that was 2007. And that was in order to align themselves more with all the other associate groups in the HMC. In 2009, Rick Seaback came here and did part of his Right Beside the River documentary on Old Economy Village. That was exciting. In 2011, Michael Knack came here as site administrator. And during that time, we were able to complete the restoration of the George and Frederick Graff houses, the interior restoration. And that opened in 2014. And just running through all of these years since 1965, Young Harmonists was established. It's a group of kids, and they help with programs on the site. We also have a lot of school tours that are always coming here during peak school tour season. This is a festival that used to take place. This is Kunstfest, and that was from the 1960s until sometime in the 1980s. Erntefest has been a festival that's been going on for a long time, and it's now known as Autumn Fest. And Christmas at the Village, that started as a 19th century Christmas and has changed into Christmas at the Village over the years. And that concludes a look back at the 100 years.